What joy. Thank you. Our call to worship. For people in darkness,
Christ is the light.
For people in despair,
Christ is the hope.
For people grieving,
Christ is a comfort.
For people burdened,
Christ is a friend to share the load.
For people anxious,
Christ is calm assurance.
For all people gathered here,
Christ is for you.
For everyone gathered here,
hear the call to follow Christ and be Christ to others.
For all in this place,
let your praise arise.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates us, redeems us, and calls us by name.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We've turned our faces away from your glory when it did not appear as we expected. We have rejected your word when it made us confront ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those you called us to welcome. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things we have left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us and lead us, that we may bathe in the glory of your Son born among us and reflect your love for all creation. Amen.
Rejoice in this good news. In Christ Jesus, your sins are forgiven. You are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ, and inheritors of eternal life. Live as freed and forgiven children of God.
Amen.
Sound of your name.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Living God, in Christ you make all things new. Transform the poverty of our nature by the riches of your grace. And in the renewal of our lives, make known your glory through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Our first reading today comes from the 17th chapter of Jeremiah. Thus says the Lord, cursed are those who trust in mere mortals and make mere flesh their strength, whose hearts turn away from the Lord. They shall be like a shrub in the desert and shall not see when relief comes. They shall live in the parched places of the wilderness in an uninhabited salt land. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. They shall be like a tree planted by water, sending out its roots by the stream. It shall not fear when heat comes, and its leaves shall stay green. In the year of drought, it is not anxious, and it does not cease to bear fruit. The heart is devious above all else. It is perverse. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, test the mind and search the heart, to give to all according to their ways, according to the fruit of their doings. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. The psalm is Psalm 1. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the way of sinners, nor sat in the seat of the scornful.
Their delight is in the law of the Lord, and they meditate on God's teaching day and night.
They are like trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper.
It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away.
Therefore the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall be destroyed. Our second reading this morning comes from the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation has been in vain and your faith has been in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified of God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have died in Christ have perished. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus came down with the 12 and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea, Jerusalem, and the coast of Tyre and Sidon. They had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases, and those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured, and all in the crowd were trying to touch him. For power came out from him and he healed all of them. Then he looked up at the disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The secret and joy of our text today come in the greeting, "May the Lord be with you." It's the presence of God that gives us strength, the presence of God that gives us joy. Those who trust in mere mortals, they're like shrubs in the desert and never see relief. We have been longing to see relief in this time of pandemic. Our pandemic team, COVID team, has been meeting every 2 weeks. We'll be meeting again on Wednesday. And we have been going through quite a challenging time. Our numbers are coming down, and that's a really good thing. And our COVID team has said that the positivity rate needs to get down below double digits for us to return back to in-person worship in the sanctuary. We'll still have Zoom, but the numbers are getting closer. Even so, our county is 3 times higher than the state average with that. And this past month has been the highest since the pandemic began of spread of the illness. We've had more deaths in this past month in our congregation from COVID than any other month since the pandemic began. It was pretty dramatic to see the rise in cases last Christmas. And we sent out a graph at one point that I want to send out a new graph, because the rise in cases this Christmas was much higher, almost 4 times higher than last Christmas. So that's pretty astounding. And now is a time that, talking to some of my colleagues, many congregations decided to remove their restrictions at Christmas time of this last year, when actually that was the very peak height of the pandemic so far. So we are like the people in the Psalm or in the Jeremiah reading, either one, longing for relief from parched places in the wilderness. And that relief will come, but our faith is placed in God, and God is the one that gives us strength and gets us through these times. That our roots we put down into God, and we receive the water, the living water for our thirst, comes from God, from deep roots that are cast, spread into the areas that will provide life, rather than from the things that are dry and death around us. Our gospel reading today, Jesus turns everything on its head. Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. This reading is from Luke. We have the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew's gospel. In Luke, it's the Sermon on the Plain. It's in a level place that they come down to. And they have this. In Matthew's gospel, it talks about, blessed are the poor in spirit, for yours is the kingdom of God. In Luke, it's not poor in spirit, it's just simply the poor. Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. I was having conversations this week about the difficulties of COVID and the difficulties that some people are going through. It's cries of lament, like the cries from the Psalms that we had today in our Bible study reading. You know, in our Bible study reading, and I'd encourage all of you to join us an hour before the worship service begins. Today, we were looking at the Psalms of Lament, and over a third of the Psalms in our 150 Psalms are Psalms of Lament, and God gives his voice to lament and cry out. Jesus says, blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh, and there is this joy coming. And as I was talking to some people this week about trying to survive through the pandemic, and I was talking with some people who have lost income, who have lost resources and who are feeling very, very weary, who are feeling stretched and like they don't have much more to give. And the person said to me, you know, I think about how much resources I have in life and how difficult it is for me. And I think about those with much fewer resources than I have, and I wonder how they can get through with life. But immediately what came to my mind are some of those people with fewer resources than I have. And you know that the people who have taught me the most about joy are the ones who have the least. And in their minds, you know, in my mind, as in our conversation, I just was all of a sudden remembering Maria Lema, a person who lived across the little dirt road from us after the earthquake in Baeza, the countryside of Ecuador. A woman who worked hard day and night, a woman who had been abused, a woman who was now a widow, a woman who was trying to raise her kids, who had just a little shack for a house. And yet she was one of the most joyful people I know. And I've talked about her before. We would have water fights together on the National Water Fight Day, and she would bring us food every day, and she'd bring us flowers. And just her being around her was this spirit of joy. I think of another woman that we named our daughter Maria after, Maria Sinaida. Her name was Sinaida, and she was the most joyful person. You know, there were struggles in her family. Her kids had disagreements and things, and yet she was this joyful person. Both Maria Lema and Sinaida told me, oh, my head doesn't work very well. Neither of them could read. But both of them were people who I thought, there's nothing wrong with your head. And they taught me a lot about joy. They are among the poor of this earth, the poorest of the people that I've met and known. And yet they told me how to live. They taught me about joy. And their secret that they had in the joy was that they looked to God. They were like these trees planted with roots, deep roots that went into God. And whenever they were thirsty and hungry and tired and weary and going through difficult times, they went down to those roots that supplied them with this joy. A joy that would rise up. And, you know, I remember one time with our gardener, who was among the low caste, low class, the poor, considered among the uneducated, the powerless. And I remember one time talking about my struggles, and he said, why are you struggling? Where's your faith? Believe in God. And, you know, again, it was this person whose life was very, very simple. The things that I learned from them was they would tell me, they had these expressions, you know, with joy, we'd say, well, see you next week. And they always say, Lord willing, if God wants it to be so. And they would always say thank you for things with the expression, may God repay you, because I don't have the means to repay you. So they lived with this awareness that their lives were in the hands of the one who is able to care for all things. It doesn't mean that they didn't have struggles and sorrow. It was, you know, Sinaida, we accompanied her in her last death where she had cancer, and we cried together at the loss, and we cried with her family about that. In fact, we returned to the U.S. and my little kids, who were preschool age, they'd learned to speak fluently in Spanish when she was living with us going through cancer treatment. And they quit speaking Spanish when we returned to the U.S. until the day that we found out that Sinaida died. That day, they switched into English, and the Spanish played all day in Spanish in her memory. But I think that that playing was something that we did together. So it wasn't that we didn't have tears, but they taught me in the midst of the tears to put my whole trust in God. You know, for some reason, it wasn't the rich and the powerful of my life who came to my mind when my sister said that, of joy, of how to get through things. My parents' neighbor was the daughter of the president. They met the president. They knew the leaders of government. They were a good friend of the minister of government and of some of the ambassadors. They knew people in the military. They knew people of power. They knew people of wealth. But the people who stand out in my mind as people of joy are the poor. And I think that they realized in some way that theirs was the kingdom of God. I don't say this in order to make us feel guilty, because I don't think that that serves any purpose. That's actually, you know, not something consistent with joy. But I say this because learning that our joy in the midst of the pandemic, in the midst of sorrow, in the midst of loss, in the midst of these things, there is this joy that flows beneath us and around us and carries us. It's the connectedness of life and the connectedness with God. And there's this beauty that comes from God every day that God wants to raise up for us. For Sinaida, her children had difficulty, but her joy came because she saw the presence of God in her midst, not because of the absence of the struggle, but because of the presence of God. You know, I'm very, very thankful for Antoinette and Sonia. They've been preparing for us in this Black History Month songs for the end of each worship service. And next week, next Sunday, the entire service will be a song of celebrating Black history and Black worship and some of the richness of that. I love the songs that they've been choosing, the song that we had closing at the end of last service, and also the song that we have at the end of the service today. I want to lift that up to you. And think about the role of music through slavery and the role of music that the Black community has given us. That in the plantation fields, if there was anyone who had reasons to be bitter, it would be the slaves, with all they lost and all they went through. And yet they had these songs of faith and trust that they would sing. And they are ones that when we hear them today, they give us power in our breathing, power in our living. I think that these songs just become something that flow through the veins of people who are oppressed, and they rise up. So I'm thankful for that, and thankful for what they teach us. We had kids in our little neighborhood. Some of them were the grandkids of Sinaida and the kids of Sinaida and Maria Lema. And they had this old go-kart. This go-kart was the most rickety, rough go-kart you ever did see. Just some old boards pounded together and some metal wheels that had been attached. They would pull this go-kart to the top of the hill in front of our house. It was not a paved road. It had lots of potholes, very rough dirt road. And they would get as many kids on it as they could. That was the goal. It wasn't something that, I don't know to this day who owned that thing. And it wasn't something about finding joy in the most up-to-date go-kart that each one had. They had an old rickety go-kart, and the joy was to see how many people they could put on it. And then they would go down the hill, and they'd go over the bumps, and they'd lose control, and they'd fly in all different directions, and they'd laugh, and they'd giggle, and the wheels would come apart, and they'd run down the hill after the wheels, pull them back up the road, pick up a rock, and nail the wheels back on with a rock, and they'd do it all over again. The joy came from the simplest things. And we have these abundant, abundant, abundant gifts from God. We are so blessed. And the idea of how many people can we get on the go-kart? How many people in our congregation can we get together to do a reach meal? How many people can we get together to worship in the morning? How many get together to do this, you know, the go-kart of the life of Christ Lutheran Church? Just get people on it and enjoy life and laugh and love. Go down the hill and see who else we can get on this ride and share the joy, share the gifts, share the grace of God. We share the sorrow, but we belong to God. Blessed are those who trust in God, whose trust is the Lord. They will be like a tree planted by water, sending out roots by the stream. It shall not fear when the heat comes, for the leaves will stay green. In the year of drought, it is not anxious. It does not cease to bear fruit. In the year of pandemic, it flourishes, loves, and cares for one another and grows. May God's peace be with you. May our roots be deep in the love of God. May that love flow through us and color our flowers and our leaves and everything we do in our exchange with other people. May God's peace spread.
Bless. rejoice and be glad. Yours is the kingdom of God.
Evan, would you lead us?
Yes. Let's recite the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Pastor, can you unmute?
Thank you. Let's pray together. Oh Lord our God, you are good to us. You are true. You are loving. You are worthy of praise. We thank you, O Lord, that you receive and permit the laments, that the scriptures are filled with laments. And yet we thank you that those laments turn to praise because you hear and you answer the cries. What would it be like if we had a God who did not allow us to lament? What would it be like if we had a God who said no complaints? Who only allowed us to say things that would be maybe lifting up to God, but not expressing what's within us. So much of the world is that way, but oh Lord, you are different than that. You receive the laments, you receive the tears, and you turn them to joy. I've known many who are poor, who are not happy, do not have rejoicing in their lives. But joy does not seem to be tied to wealth. It's tied to coming to you, turning to you, crying out to you, and experiencing your response. So this day we cry out to you. We come to you with our joys. We come to you with our concerns. We come to you with our loves. We come to you with the things we can't understand. And in turn, we receive joy from sharing those things with you and to hearing your response and your goodness. We thank you, O Lord, for your goodness, Lord, and your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, we come to you with communities across the world struggling and how to live in these days. Last month was the highest spread so far of the pandemic, and now the spread is declining quickly, and we're thankful for that. We are very eager to come back to in-person worship, but we ask, O Lord, when these days are difficult, when incomes change, when customs change, when so many things are different, when we are grieving more deaths now than ever before, we ask that we would learn to put our roots into you and that you would come and care for our world. That our communities, O Lord, that are tossed about would be nourished and fed and watered by you. We ask for the leaders of this world that they would, O Lord, be led by your Spirit to look out for the good of all people. That corruption would be overcome, O Lord. We come to you and pray for those places who know violence, We have become weary of the pandemic. Others are weary of gunfire and bombs. And we come and ask for peace for our world. We come and ask, O Lord, for peace between our nations, especially the tensions between the U.S. and Russia at this time, and Ukraine. We ask for wisdom, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, we ask for strength for our schools. We thank you for the joy and the beauty that our kids bring and the creativity of teachers. We thank you for the resources you provide, and we ask, O Lord, that you would renew their strength, that you would quicken the learning, that you would help them to be able to communicate when so many communication challenges are there, that you would keep our children safe, O Lord, as they go to school with others, that you would give strength and wisdom to the leaders of schools. We ask for our hospitals, our care centers, our care providers, that you would provide strength and newness and health and protection to those who provide care, that you would provide for those who are sick and depending on them and their families. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, we bring before you those who are on our prayer requests. We lift them before you and ask for you to hear the cries. We thank you, O Lord, that you are the source of healing and goodness. We raise before you Suzanne Dolan, who has surgery coming up soon. For Kiri, O Lord, with his heart surgery, recovery. For April, her friend who's found unconscious and is still needing your healing touch. We pray, O Lord, for Andy, a friend who was deployed in emergency. We ask for all the soldiers, all those who are in harm's way, that you would watch over them and protect them, that you would protect the families, and that we would find peaceful ways to resolve our differences. We pray, O Lord, for Steve Stefano, who's recovering, for Debbie Otto and her illness, for Karen Ford, Gary Atherholtz, Harry Gillum, Ted Hare, Barbara Simmons, Rayanne and Jeff Smith, Mark Jenkins, Linda McCaw and her mother, Connie Otto, Carolyn Yammer, Retta Hanlon, Janice Whitney, Jack Zeeland, Rick Pryor, Joyce de Munbrun, Lisa and Dave Ahern, Laura Murray, Mitzi and Jerry Robinette, Bill Crawford, Mary Lou Rose, Jane Dawson, Patty Wilson, Anna Brooke, Sharon McKenzie, Sharon Schaefer, Mary Kiefer, Keith and Naomi Zeiler, Carol Barger, Roxy Sliviak, Wally Swanson, and for those we name now, silently or loud. May your mercy, your healing presence, the strength of your joy come, O Lord, and surround them, and raise them up and dry their tears. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, we bring before you those who have passed away. We commend them to your care, to your raising power, the power of resurrection. We pray for their families, O Lord, and ask that you would bring them comfort and strength at this time, that you would give them your peace. We pray, O Lord, for the family of Kenny Printy, for Elwood and his family and the loss of his sister-in-law, Jean Glass, for the family of Karen King, for the family of Clem Pope, and for those we name now silently or loud. Thank you, O Lord, that the resurrection is yours, and that your people rise up resilient again and again and again by your power. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Oh Lord, we're thankful this day for Pastor Donald Saucy and his birthday, his life, and all that he has contributed to us, for his faith, for his wife, and we ask that you would bless him in this time, as he has blessed so many. We're thankful, oh Lord, for him and for his testimony and for the goodness that you have given him all these years. So we rejoice, oh Lord, in celebrating his life and the goodness that you give us through him. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, as we've been praying and reading scriptures this day, we've heard the little voices in Devin's home. As he reads scripture, and we're thankful for the little ones in our lives, in our communities, for our grandkids, our great-grandkids, for the new births of babies, for the joy that comes, for the hope that is there, rising, bounding all around us with energy that sometimes we can't keep up with. It is a sign of your goodness that keeps coming and keeps coming and keeps coming, like a river that never stops. We are blessed. We are yours. To Jesus we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Peace of the Lord be with you, Addie.
Peace be with all.
Good job. Amen.
Peace. There you go.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. My feet and a light unto my path.
Blessed are you, O God, sovereign of the universe. You offer us new beginnings and guide us on our journey. Lead us to your table, nourish us with heavenly food. Prepare us to carry your love to a hungry world. In the name of Christ, our light.
Amen. Let us pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now receive the blessing. God who lends you pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you and who calls you by name. Bless your going out and your coming in today and forever. Amen.
Amen. Into a weary world. Share the good news.
Thanks be to God. And now listen to the song that is chosen by Antoinette and Sonia for our Black History Month. It's a good song.